said to Abraham, get rid of that slave woman and her son, for that woman's son will never share in the inheritance with my son, Isaac. The matter distressed Abraham greatly because it concerned her son. But God said to him, do not be so distressed about the boy and your slave woman. Listen to whatever Sarah tells you, because it is through Isaac that your offspring will be reckoned. I will make the son of the slave into a nation also, because he is your offspring. Early the next morning, Abraham took some food and a skin of water and gave them to Hagar. He set them on her shoulders and then sent her off with the boy. She went on her way and wandered in the desert of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she put the boy under one of the bushes. And then she went off and sat down about a bow shot away, for she thought, I cannot watch the boy die. And as she sat there, she began to sob. God heard the boy crying, and the angel of God called to Hagar from heaven and said to her, what is the matter, Hagar? Do not be afraid. God has heard the boy crying as he lies there. Lift the boy up and take him by the hand, for I will make him into a great nation. May the Lord add his blessings to his most precious word today. Amen. Praise the Lord. Just going to switch over at this time. Again, we welcome all of you to our service today. And we know that God's presence is with us, for the Lord says that wherever two or three persons gather in his name, that he is in our midst, and we give him praise and glory. Amen. 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 Praise the Lord. Our subject today is the consequences of unresolved issues. The consequences of unresolved issues. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you that your word is already blessed. We thank you, O God, for this gathering, all of us who have come to sit around your word. Your word is truth. Lord, we know that there are needs in our midst, dear God, that you desire to minister to. That those, dear God, with challenges from the past that are resurfacing, that are constantly, dear God, reminding them of these events that have taken place in the past. We know, dear God, that you desire only the best for your people. So, Lord, we pray even now that you would cause your word, dear God, to bring healing. Cause your word to bring deliverance. Cause your word to shed light in dark places in our lives, in our hearts, in our families, oh God. And bring hope to everyone today. And save those, oh God, who may be online right now, who do not know you as Lord and Savior. We ask these things in Jesus' name. And everyone says, amen. Amen. Unresolved issues are like COVID-19. You can't see it, or you can't see them. You can't touch them. You can't smell them. They stay unseen. And one day, when the circumstance, like all circumstances that are covered, when the right event occurs, what we hear is almost like a kaboom. And the world, or your world, or that person's life is turned upside down. The person's life that has unresolved issues is turned upside down. The Bible is the most accurate account about mankind and his relationship with God. The Bible provides accounts about real issues, real life issues. The Bible is not a book like a sitcom, like a movie. The Bible gives us accounts of events that are real. Every aspect of human nature is revealed in the scriptures. And the good is revealed, the bad is revealed, and the ugly is revealed. It shows us how we live. The Bible shows us how we love, And the Bible also shows us how we can hate at times. Thank God the Bible also provides the means to healing, deliverance, and restoration from unresolved issues. The Bible also reveals how unresolved issues are when bottled up and left unresolved can be as destructive as a bomb when it goes off. Unresolved issues in our lives manifest in a number of ways, in several ways. Some of them manifest in the form of hate, as in the case of Esau, who hated his brother Jacob because he stole his birthright. He hated him for many years, and though he had to run away for his life to save his life, he was still hated by his brother. Unresolved issues lead to jealousy. In the case of King Saul, though he had brought David into his circle, as it were, to defend the kingdom, and David, we know, had killed Goliath, King Saul got very jealous of David. He never pulled David aside and said, David, I thank you. I appreciate what you've done for me. I want to let you know that I acknowledge the good that you have done. But when the ladies began to sing the song that Saul had killed his thousands and David his 10,000s, jealousy rose up in King Saul's heart, and he plotted to take David's life. But unresolved issues do not only cause people to plot to take other people's lives. Unresolved issues can lead to murder. An unresolved issue led to the murder in David's kingdom, and several other instances also occurred. We know of the time when Absalom killed his own brother, Amnon, after he discovered that Amnon had taken his half-sister and abused her and raped her. David did not take any action. David did not bring justice in the situation. And as a result, Absalom waited and he plotted and he killed his own brother. We also know of how Cain killed Abel out of jealousy. So unresolved issues can be very, very destructive. Unresolved issues can be very, very emotionally wrecking as well. People live for many years with unresolved issues, and for many, many years, they never seem to get past them, because all it takes is some trigger, as it were, a trigger, and all of those events, all of those unresolved issues return and become a reality once again. So unresolved issues can be very destructive to family relationships. I give you a quick illustration, a quick example, a real life situation. I'm aware of a situation right now where a mother, a parent died recently, not during the COVID season, just during the COVID season. And she died and left siblings or children behind. And would you know that because of unresolved issues between two daughters in the family, they are having two separate memorials for the mother because the daughters can't get along. They don't speak to each other. And it's so sad that unresolved issues divide family members. And sometimes it takes a traumatic event. I've also heard of many accounts where during the COVID season, family members who have not been speaking to each other for many years have reached out to loved ones. And because of the fear, because of the apprehension of the COVID, they have reconciled. So unresolved issues, all they need is a trigger, and they resurface again. In our text, we see a dysfunctional family which was caused by an unresolved matter. And though the event occurred over 4,000 years ago, the consequences of this event that we just read about is still manifesting itself today. You see, the two families that were birthed from these two boys were the Jews from Isaac and the Arabs or the Muslims from Ishmael. And the name, the person Abraham, is held in high esteem among the three major religious groups in the world, the Jews, the Christians, and the Muslims. To the Jews, they see him as Father Abraham, the great father of the nation Israel. To the Christians, we see him as the father of faith, the one who took his son Isaac on the mountain top, on Mount Moriah, and he believed that if he had taken his son's life, that God was able to raise him up again. We know Abraham to be the father of faith, because by faith, Abraham left his home. He left his country. He left his people. And he obeyed. He followed the word of the Lord and went to a country that he didn't know of. To the Arabs recognize Abraham as a great patriarch of obedience. The Arabs see him, and the Muslims see him as a great patriarch of obedience, because when the Lord told him to take his son on the mountain, he did not question God, he did not relent, but he went and he followed the Lord fully. At a glance, or at the first level of seeing the life of Abraham, one may think that Abraham had it all together. He had it going all together. He has his life put together well. He had great wealth as the Lord had blessed him abundantly. And these things came to pass. His seed became more than the sand of the seashore and more than the stars of the sky, so to speak. But beneath it all, there were unresolved issues in his life. And these unresolved issues continue until today. According to the account, the firstborn of Abraham, who was born to Hagar, his wife's maid, our servant, he became the father of all the Arabs. And he believed back then that he should have received the birthright. You see, under the culture, in the culture at that time, the firstborn had the right to the majority, the major portion of the father's possessions. But that did not happen. As a result, the boy was, because of the jealousy between, at least because of the anger and the hatred that was manifested between the two boys and the two mothers, Hagar was pushed out of the house. The friction between the two boys caused Abraham to be caught in the middle. This is a situation that is prevalent in our society today. There's so many children and so many mothers that have to share their families with other mothers and other children and other offspring from other groups of families. And very often do we find that these events causes friction among these families, this type of family setting. Like any wife or mother, Sarah insisted that Hagar and her son Ishmael be put out of the house. Now, mind you, we need to understand that Ishmael is the firstborn of Abraham. And because he began to mock Isaac when he was born, Sarah became angry. She told Abraham, "You have to get rid of this woman. You have to get this boy out of the house." And Abraham seemingly sought the Lord, because Abraham's heart was hurt. And the Lord told him, listen to your wife. Listen to your wife. And you know the old saying, happy wife, happy life. So this goes way back then. This made Sarah happy. And Hagar and her son Ishmael were put out of the house. So here, Hagar was given a basket of food. Now, mind you, this is all that she got from Abraham. She was given a basket or a container of food and a container of water. She was told to leave the house and to go and to live in the sand under the sun. The Bible lets us know clearly that she left and entered into the desert to live. Now, for over 4,000 years now, the Arab nations and the Jewish people, though they are brothers, blood brothers, they have not been able to get along. One of the primary missions of every United States president for many years now, I wouldn't go back to how many years, but probably for all of history, one of the primary missions of every president that goes into the White House has been to bring peace between the Jews and the Arabs, especially since the Seven-Day War that occurred. They have been trying their best to bring peace between the Jews and the Arabs, and no one has been able to resolve this issue. Even our current president has been trying to bring peace between the Jews and the Arabs, and the problem continues because there have been unresolved issues in this family. Unresolved issues have serious consequences. I've come today to let us know that America is facing a number of crises today, and many of the crises that we are facing today are the result of major unresolved issues. We can elect who we want to elect. We can appoint who we want to appoint. We can march and protest all we want. But until we come together to address the unresolved issues that are in this country historically, we are going to be facing the serious consequences that are manifesting in our nation today. Many of the unresolved issues in America have been swept under the rug, so to speak, and are still being swept under the rug. With Abraham and Sarah wanted to have use Hagar as a surrogate mother, she didn't even have a choice in the matter. Mind you, she was their slave. She was a household slave. And though she might have felt a little esteem, a little pride in being able to marry, the Bible calls it marry, but actually sleep with her master and produce a child, she had no choice in the matter. Similarly, when we look at the United States of America, when the European settlers needed cheap labor and they planted their crops and needed people to harvest them and work the fields, they went to Africa, and the people there were kidnapped and brought to this country, and they had no choice but to go out into the fields and to the work, but provide slave labor. We've seen some parallels here in the biblical account and the reality that have existed in our country for hundreds of years and things that still exist today. And the problem is that the unjust and the injustice that has been met out against Hagar and her son is a similar injustice that the Africans who came to this country many, many years ago experienced, and in many cases are still experiencing. Africans did not want to come here. They didn't want to come here. In fact, history lets us know that after many of the Africans realized that people were constantly coming to the shores of Africa, and there were people who were constantly disappearing, and they weren't even being given a chance to wish their family members goodbye. They were just being kidnapped and taken on ships, and many of them, before they came to the United States, were thrown overboard when they became ill, or thrown overboard for whatever reason. They began to commit suicide. Africans began to commit suicide, take their own lives in Africa, because they didn't want to be kidnapped and brought to this country. They had no choice in the matter. After Hagar produced Abraham and Sarah, the son that they wanted, they had no more value for her. In fact, when we notice how there was a transition in the name, they referred to her as Hagar when she was supposed to have a child or to sleep with Abraham. But after she had the child and the time came for her to be pushed out of the house. They referred to her only as that slave woman. That slave woman. The Portuguese, the Spanish, the French, the English, and so many other Europeans who engaged in the slave trade and made what would amount to be in the billions and hundreds of billions of dollars from slaves who worked in the sun, from sun up in the fields, from sun up until sundown, had no use for the African after slavery ended. They had no use. They were of no value. The Africans were viewed as property. So just like Abraham and Sarah, they had no value for the Africans. They freed the slaves in the Confederate states first, simply to have them fight for the Union during the war, the Civil War. Then after the war ended, they promised them 60 acres and a mule, which they never got. Then after they worked them on the same plantations as sharecroppers. And as a sharecropper, all you did was work as a slave all over again. And all you got as your payment as was just what Abraham gave to Hagar, a bag of food and a container of water. Because they didn't have any money to do anything, to engage in commerce or business. They were working as slaves even after they were released from under slavery. So, does this sound familiar to you? Then after the slaves claimed their rights under the Constitution, a little later on, we had the Jim Crow laws that were imposed upon the quote-unquote former slaves. They were passed down upon these men and women of color. One of these rules or laws that indicated or implied that a slave or a person of color was only 3/5 of a human, indicating that they were sub or partial human and that they had no rights to claim any benefits from the Constitution as a human. In other words, the African was only viewed after the Jim Crow laws were passed as a subhuman, not a person, not a whole person that was due rights, civil rights, and justice under the law. These unresolved issues, sad to say, continues until today. These unresolved issues continue today in the form of redlining, where people were permitted to buy property in certain areas only. Banks refused to give loans to people of color because of who they were and where they lived. They were redlined because they were excluded from certain jobs and positions in society. These issues continue today in the prison industrial complex. And I refuse to go into the statistics. We could have, but we don't want to spend too much time with these statistics because we've shared many of them before. This country, though it has a small proportion relatively of African-American men in it, we have a large disproportion of men of color locked away in prison. These unresolved issues continue today, where people of color are limited in their housing, they're limited in their education, they're limited in their lack of health care, the lack of health care that is available to them. And you know what? The lynching continues today. The lynching that took place during the Jim Crow era and before that continues today. When we see men having a knee put in their necks, when we see men being shot in the back, and there is impunity for these acts. There is no justice for these acts. There is no resolution in these acts. It lets us know that these unresolved issues that took place in our country over 400 years ago are still ongoing. And my message today is that until these unresolved issues are dealt with, until these unresolved issues are pulled out from under the carpet, lifted up from the under the rug, these consequences that we are seeing on the streets will continue. It will continue because God is a just God. Well, unresolved issues always have consequences. And this is why there is the civil unrest in the streets. However, whenever an oppressed people rises up to speak out for their rights, whenever any oppressed person or people rise up to claim their rights and to seek for justice, they're always given a label. And I want to inform the listeners today that we cannot allow ourselves to be fooled by the rhetoric, by the lies, by the labels that are being placed upon people who are crying out for the lives of their sons and their daughters. I heard just this past week, the most recent case, where after this man was shot in the back seven times in the back, which means that he was not posing an immediate threat to this particular officer. They have now taken him in the hospital and discovered that he is paralyzed in his body. He cannot walk. He cannot run. He cannot try to escape. But in the hospital where he is, his hands are shackled to the bed where he is laying. Now you tell me that this is justice. You tell me that this is a path to resolving these deep, painful issues. It is sad. It is sad. We have some deep unresolved issues in our country, issues of hate that are still being manifested in our society. But we were talking about the labels that are placed upon individuals when they cry out for deliverance from the oppressor. When Moses told Pharaoh to let the people of God go, you know what Moses labeled the children of God with? He said, these Hebrews are lazy. These Hebrews are lazy. And people of color are often referred to as lazy. Well, if we can't get a job, when we go to college and we have a bachelor's degree, or we have a high school diploma, or we go to a trade school and we learn skills and crafts, when we have a master's degree or doctorate degree, but there's a glass ceiling over us where there's a limitation on how far we can advance in our society, then we know that we have unresolved issues. And we are often referred to as lazy people. I'm sure that the slaves were referred to as lazy. Meanwhile, they were the ones who were working before the rise of the sun. And they were the ones who were working sometimes under the light of the moon from sun up to sundown without any health care, without any proper housing. We hear of the storms coming through our country and destroying well-built structures. They're tearing trees down. We've seen them around here in New York recently. But yet these people are referred to as lazy. As lazy. And then we saw how Hagar referred to her worker, her household maid, as a slave woman. Well, we had a case recently during the civil rights era when Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., though he was fighting for the rights of his people, though he was fighting for the freedom of his people, though he was fighting for justice in the country and equity, nothing more than what the Constitution stipulates. This is what the argument was based upon. Give the people the rights to vote. Give the people the rights to work and to take care of their families, because the Constitution dictates it. But you know how they label him? They label him a communist. In fact, this is one of the labels that is often used by many, many individuals who do not want to set the oppressed free. And anytime You determined to rise up and to speak out for your rights, or to speak out for the rights of your family, or to speak out against the injustice that we see in the streets. You label something that is absurd, something that causes you to be seen by the masses as a threat to the status quo. So they label Dr. King a communist, and those who call for equity in the streets today, those who call for the rights of people who have died, and the list is long, and almost daily this list is growing of men and women who are being shot. And mind you, we only heard of this case because someone had a camera. Someone had a presence of mind to whip a camera out and record it. Otherwise, we would not know a thing. We would not know the facts of what really happened. But I dare to tell you, this is happening over and over and over throughout this country, and oftentimes around the world as well. Thank God for cell phones. Thank God for these cameras that we have. Today, we have individuals who are marching the streets and crying out for justice, crying out for help, crying out to have these unresolved issues addressed. And you know how they're being labeled? They're being labeled as vandals. They're being labeled as terrorists. They're being labeled as looters and vagabonds. But listen, we are not here to promote or to advocate the destruction of property. We are not here today endorsing the destruction and the burning of property. But what we know is that there are those who are penetrating the marches and penetrating those who are protesting. And they themselves are doing the looting. They themselves are breaking into buildings. They themselves are setting police precincts on fire. And they're caught. They're blaming it on the protesters and calling them vandals and terrorists and looters when they just want to quiet the situation down and shut them down. But listen, as long as this preacher here has a voice, as long as I know the God of heaven, as long as I have breath in my body, I will not sit around and watch the injustice continue in the streets around me. Because as I was sharing recently, it may come to my house one day and I may need someone to stand and to march for me, or one of my sons, or maybe my wife. When we sit around and we stay quiet in the face of injustice, when we sit around behind the scenes and we use social media as a weapon to speak out in support of injustice, we are just as bad as those who are pulling the trigger. We are just as bad as those who are kneeling in the necks of the innocent in the streets. Silence in the face of injustice is silence everywhere and in every situation where injustice is taking place. So today, we have a world, we have a nation with unresolved issues. And until these unresolved issues are dealt with in an equitable way, in a just way, in a fair way, we're gonna have consequences. My message: the consequences of unresolved issues. But I dare to tell you today that time alone never solves unresolved issues. Because this is now 4,000 years, over 4,000 years, since Abraham had a child with Hagar, and the strife and the hate that exists between the Jews and the Arabs continues today, over 4,000 years later. Time alone does not correct unresolved issues. People perpetrate crimes and they think that they will get away with it. They think that after a week or a month or 2 years and no one has apprehended them, that they will get away with it. But thank God the Lord has given us what we know to be a conscience. Hallelujah. We all have a conscience, And I believe that God has given us a conscience because he knew that there will be time, a time, and there are times when the law that is supposed to be equal and just for all people will be subverted. God knew that there will be injustice in the earth. God knew that people will do each other wrong. And this is why when the Lord confronted Cain after he killed his brother Abel, the Lord said, listen, your brother's blood is crying up from the ground right now. I have heard the cries of your brother's blood, and there are people who have committed crimes, and they go home thinking that because of time they will be able to get over these crimes. But oftentimes we hear how they're committing suicide in their houses, they're jumping off of bridges, they're taking their own lives. And we are not advocating that people go and kill themselves. We are not celebrating when people commit suicide. But we know that God has given us a conscience, and we have to let our conscience be our guide. I think of Judas. Judas was a greedy man. And Judas thought that he could sell Jesus for 30 pieces of silver and get away with it. But you know what? His conscience bothered him. And when he saw what happened to Jesus on that Good Friday afternoon, his conscience bothered him, and he recognized that this money was not worth it. He took the money up and he went back to the high priest and he said, here's your money, take your money. And the priest threw the money back at him, he said, take your money and go. Judas could not live with the crime that he committed against the Son of God. The Bible lets us know that he went out and he hung himself. Sometimes when I look at the situation that plagues this nation, the only thing that consoles me is the fact of the matter that there is a God in heaven who does not sleep. There is a God in heaven who knows what is happening under the sun. He knows everything that happens in the dark. He knows what happens behind the prison doors. He knows what happens in every situation, in every home in this world today. God knows, and God is a just judge. He is not only a holy God. He is not only a righteous God. Our God is a just God. And when we see our country closed down today, that when we see that all of the ballparks are closed up, when we see that all of the malls are closed up, when we see that Wall Street is shut down, the schools are closed up, when we see everywhere closed up, and the streets have become like a vacated or empty place, we know that God is speaking from heaven. God is speaking to the United States of America, and he is saying to this country, you have unresolved issues. America, you have unresolved issues that need to be dealt with. These issues need to be dealt with. Pretending that truth is not a reality does not mean that truth does not exist. It does not mean that truth does not exist. Like Abraham, Abraham was wealthy. Abraham was great. Abraham was proud. But Abraham had a sickness in his family that still till today needs healing. It needs justice. It needs reconciliation. It needs to have the parties to sit at a table with honesty, with sincerity, and a resolve to resolve this issue, to bring peace between these two groups of peoples. The resolution to America's unresolved issues is available. There's hope, because the resolution to America's unresolved issues is available. Three steps. One, America needs to acknowledge the injustice and the corruption that has taken place at every level in its society, not only against Africans and people of color, but also people in general. People across the board, thank God, even in the church had to open up her vaults recently and repay those who were abused in the church. And finally, they had to, the conscience of the church, at least in that one particular segment of the church, is being cleared. And the healing is coming to that particular church. Secondly, the nation needs to take an honest and necessary steps to address the issues that we face. We cannot come to these issues with biases. We cannot come to the issues with our hands hiding things in our pockets. I remember a few years while working for the MTA. Yes, I'll call the names. While working for the MTA, they went to the management, to the union, to create a contract. And they sat down and said, we only have limited resources to sit and to negotiate this contract. And a few days or weeks after the contract was negotiated, they discovered that they had $500 million hidden away in a bank account that they never allowed the union to know that they had hidden away. This is facts. These are truths. So when we come to resolve these issues, we have to lay all of our cards on the table. You may be there today as a husband or a wife. You may be here today as a child with unresolved issues, things that are hidden, things that are hidden away that you do not know, want anyone to know about. But until these things are rooted up and brought to the table, until the truth comes out, you will continue to experience the consequences of sleepless nights. You will continue to experience the restlessness. You will continue to have the triggers occurring in your life when events occur. When this man, George Floyd, died in the streets and the whole world saw, it triggered something in the hearts and the minds of the onlookers, people who were black, people who were young, people who were old, people who were white. Could not stand it any longer. And they came out on the streets. And they are coming out on the streets. Because our nation still has unresolved issues. The change in government is not going to do it. A $600 check to buy food and pay bills is not going to resolve these issues. Even if we receive medical care, these are not going to resolve the issues. We need to have reconciliation. We need to have repentance of the wrong and the wrongs that are being done in our nation. We need to have healing take place in our nation. And I thank God that God has given us the formula for the healing in America. He's given us the formula in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. He said, if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, he said, he'll hear from heaven. He will forgive our sins and he will heal our lands. Church, we have the formula for the healing of our land. And this is why God has called us as a church. This is why God is calling the nation to come to a place of repentance, come to a place of reconciliation, come to a place of healing. Hallelujah. And I'm personally believing that the Lord is going to bring healing as a result of us following his formula. Hallelujah. I'm convinced of it. We need to follow the example of the great David, the king of Israel. We need to follow the example of David, the king of Israel. After David had sinned with Bathsheba, and he went out and he killed her husband Uriah. We saw the consequences of that. The baby that was conceived died. My God. And then the Bible lets us know when you study the history of David, you will see that the sword had never left the house of David. Even David's son Absalom rose up against him and deposed him from the kingdom. And then Absalom went on the rooftop and slept with all of David's wives in the public eyes of all the people in Jerusalem. Because there are always consequences to unresolved issues. And sometimes the consequences are more dire than the issue that needs to be resolved. But thank God, David came to his senses one day, and David came before God and asked God to have mercy upon him. And David penned a psalm about this state of repentance, this state of remorse, this state of repentance. And he wrote these words in Psalm 51. He said, I have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. He said, according to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions, wash away all my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sins are always before me. Did you hear that? David said, my transgressions and my sins are always before me. We cannot wash away unresolved issues with a bath. We cannot wash away unresolved issues with a sauna. We cannot wash away unresolved issues with a vacation in paradise. We cannot wash away unresolved issues with natural things. We have to go deep down in our souls. David said here, for I know my transgressions are always before me. He said, against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desire faithfulness. Even in the womb, you taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, hallelujah, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. My God, people with unresolved issues need to come before God honestly and get our consciences clear. Nations that have perpetrated crimes against their citizens and against others need to come before God in repentance. God is calling for America to come before him in repentance. Come before him and acknowledge our wrong. Come before him. God has given us lots of time. It is over 6 months now that the churches have been closed. They're telling us we can go back in with a handful of people. They're saying you have to call the pastor and make an appointment to go to church. What utter nonsense. What utter nonsense. Anytime I have to call to make an appointment to go to church, let me tell you something. I ain't going, and I'm not teaching, and I'm not preaching either. Hallelujah. The word of God says to come boldly to the throne of grace. At any time I'm going into the house of God, I am going into the house of God with confidence, because I know my God, hallelujah, is able to protect me. I know my God is the one in whom I trust, and he's able to do exceeding abundantly above all we can ask or even think. Hallelujah. Finally, the unresolved issues in our lives, the unresolved issues in our country, will continue to have dire consequences until we ask ourselves the question, Lord, what do you desire of me? What do you want of me? This is the question that Amos declared to Israel, and this was the response that God gave him. We need to act justly. We need to act justly to our wives. We need to act justly to our children. We need to act justly to our neighbor. We need to act justly to our citizens. But he didn't end there. He said we need to love mercy. Love mercy. We need to be merciful to those around us. And thirdly, we need to walk humbly before our God. I challenge you, my dear brothers and sisters, to not allow unresolved issues in your marriage, not allow unresolved issues in your home, not allow unresolved issues in relationships. Very often we have people who have unresolved issues in their home, and they go to the job, and the unresolved issue manifests. And it happens in the converse as well. People have issues on the job, and they bring the issue, the unresolved issues at the home. They're those who have unresolved issues in the home, and they bring those problems in the church. And we want to know in the church, what is wrong with this person? Is this person mentally sick? But what has happened is they have unresolved issues in their lives. God is crying. God is asking His people today to put those unresolved issues on the altar of honesty, on the altar of sincerity, on the altar of transparency, on the altar of integrity, hallelujah, and allow Him to take care of it. There's some unresolved issues that only God can resolve. There's some unresolved issues that only God can resolve. And one of these issues is sin. Sin, the Bible says that we were all born in sin and shaped in iniquity. And the wages of sin, the consequence of sin is death. And the only way that the consequence of sin can be resolved, can be neutralized in the lives of every person born on this earth, is for us to come to the cross of Jesus Christ and allow Him, hallelujah, to heal the sin, remove the sin, the guilt of the sin that is in our lives. I challenge you today, my people. I challenge you today. Let us get these unresolved issues dealt with. And let us work to resolve the issues in our lives, in our families, in our nation, so that we can live at peace with our fellow man. God bless you today. Let's bow our hearts before the Lord. Father God, we thank you today for the opportunity to share your word with your people. We know, God, that there's a reason why you sent this word. You sent this word for some individual or individuals. Maybe it's a person who has had some situation hidden in their lives, and each time something happens, each time the event occurs, it triggers the memories of that event, and the guilt returns, my God. Lord, we recognize that enjoying the things of this world, the pleasures of this world, the wealth of this world, the fame of this world cannot resolve some of the unresolved issues that are deeply seated in the soul of our lives. So God, we come to you today asking you to have mercy upon each one of us. Search us, oh God, as David cried. Search us and know our ways. Try us and know our thoughts. And see if there's any wicked way in us, oh God. And heal us. And if you're there today and you have never accepted Jesus Christ in your life, you have an unresolved issue, because the word of God lets us know that we all have to stand before the judgment seat of God and give an account of the lives that we lived on this earth. And if you're there, you have never invited Christ to be the Lord of your life. I invite you right now to come to the cross, come to the place where this unresolved issue of sin can be canceled once and for all. Pray this simple prayer with us today right now. Pray after me, and God will forgive you of every sin. God will heal you. He will set you free. Pray this prayer with me now, right now, in the name of Jesus. Say, Lord Jesus, I thank you that you love me so much that you refuse to allow me to continue in my life of sin. Jesus, forgive me. I'm a sinner. Cleanse me and make me clean. Make me your child. From this day onward, I will serve you. Help me, Lord, to love you. Help me, Lord, to read your word. Help me, Lord, to understand your plan for my life. And I thank you for resolving this issue today, this issue of my sin, in Jesus' name. Amen. If you pray this prayer with us, drop us a line, send us an email, send us a note, and let us know that you have invited Christ into the life, in your life, and you have once and for all resolved this issue of sin. For those of us who are believers and have some situation in your life that is unresolved, I encourage you to continue to trust God, because he's able to do all things. God bless you today. Thank you for joining us again here at Destiny Cathedral for this time of worship via Zoom. And we invite you to join us tomorrow again for prayer. Amen. Prayer at 12 noon. Bible study. We'll be studying. We'll be looking at our 40-day fast beginning. And then we're going to continue for a few weeks in this theme and believing God for great things in the future. Listen, there is hope. The end. This is not the end of you. There is hope in Jesus Christ. There is hope in the Lord. And we give him all the glory and all the praise in Jesus' name. God bless you.